Blessed are those who have not seen and yet believe. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit, amen. There are two things that take place on this new Sunday. One is, of course, the profession of the faith of St. Thomas. And the second is why we call it New Sunday, this eighth day following our Lord. Now, that makes for two sermons, and I'm not going to do two sermons because we're already here long enough as it is. So what I recommend to you is that in the bulletin this week, I have written up specifically on the meaning of New Sunday. In short, what it is, as we celebrated and commemorated last week with the resurrection of our Lord, and considered last week of the new creation, the transformation that begins really for the cosmos in the nature, the human nature of our divine Lord, and then radiates outwardly, to which we're invited. But amongst the creatures of the world, there is also time. We often think of time as being some kind of an absolute, it's just there, like space. But both space and time are results and effects of creatures. If creatures don't exist, there is no space, there is no time. They are creatures. New Sunday, the eighth day, that we call in the Greek term the Opdoad, is commemorating that transformation of time by the resurrection. That's all I need to say. The rest of it's in the bulletin. This other aspect is the profession of faith of St. Thomas. What's fascinating, and again I encourage you to go and read the end of the Gospel of St. John. St. John has, in effect, two endings. And this one paragraph that you have in the bulletin saying that our Lord did many other things, but we did not in this book because there's not enough space or time. But that what we write to you is so that you may have reason for your belief. That is almost repeated, word for word, at the end, the very end of the Gospel. We have two episodes. St. Thomas is this one. And then chapter 21 of the Gospel of St. John deals with Simon Peter. Do you love me? Do you love me? Do you love me? Feed my lambs, feed my sheep, feed my sheep. And so we have a contrast. We have two episodes, one dealing with faith, one dealing with charity. These two primary things by which we are transformed in the light of God. And then they both finish by giving testimony that Jesus did many other things that even if we tried to write them out, I don't think that all of the books of the world would be able to contain it. So we have two episodes and two endings. Now, with St. Thomas, of course, where we get our term Doubting Thomas, is this whole episode today. St. Thomas is not present on the day of the resurrection. We have no idea why not. But on Easter Sunday morning, he's not with the other apostles. So that when our Lord appears to the apostles on that morning, last week, St. Thomas not being there, he's told by the apostles, we've seen the Lord. And he hears from the women, we saw him in the garden. And the apostles say, but he appeared to us in this room, in this upper room. And Thomas's answer is very modern, very human. And he ignores these 15, 16, 17 people that have seen our Lord, at least. And he says, unless I see the marks of the nails, unless I can touch him, I won't believe. Now, this is pretty audacious because, of course, he's known these men for years. He's lived with them. He's known these women for years. And he disregards their testimony. Hence, the reason why I pointed out in the Gospel of St. John, we have two blocks referring to St. John's intention, which is not just simply to give the history in the Gospel of what took place, but that this is not only a history, but also a testimony to the reasons why you should believe this. So then, of course, we have this famous this episode on the eighth day. Now, in the translation that we have in the lectionary, it says the week later. But in fact, it says quite strictly 8 days. On the eighth day, our Lord appears once again out of the middle of nowhere, in the middle of them. They're in this room and our Lord appears there. And he gives them the same greeting he gave them on the morning of the resurrection. Peace be to you. Shalom lechum. And then he looks at Thomas and he says, all right, come here. Put your finger in the holes. Put your hand in my side. Now, what is interesting in this text, of course, is there's no discussion about St. Thomas repeating what he had said. Our Lord knows what he had said during this week. And this is a rebuke. The first detail to notice here, which is quite fascinating, is that the wounds are open. You can put your hand into our Lord's side. A lot of times when you'll do in spiritual readings and things, they'll talk about our Lord's scars and everything, as if it was healed over, like your hernia operation. But these wounds are open. Now, obviously, our Lord doesn't suffer from them. But it's a fascinating aspect, as we mentioned on Good Friday, our Lord is in complete control at all times. And at the very moment of his death and his loud voice, Father, into your hands I commend my spirit. And then he chooses to die. There is a victory and death, a life and death simultaneous in that moment on Calvary and in this moment of the resurrection. You can see the wounds that I have that are open. Now, St. John, the same author of this gospel, is also the writer of the Apocalypse, the book of Revelation. And in chapter 5 there, we also have a recounting of this fascinating detail about our Lord's resurrection. Because when he's in heaven, and it's chapter 5, and the beginning of the judgment upon the earth and the appearance of Christ, you have the famous scroll of the seven seals, the scroll rolled up, with these bandings and ribbons hanging off and the seals on the bottom of them. And no one is worthy to open the seals. And so St. John is upset by this and he begins to cry because this is the moment in which everything has been created for this moment of the revelation of the glory of God and no one can initiate it. No one can start it. But the angel who's standing next to St. John says, no, 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 stop crying. And then he says, behold, the Lion of Judah. This Old Testament terminology for the Messiah. This conquering, majestic animal used as a symbol of the conquering and triumphant Messiah. But St. John says that as he looks up to see the Lion of Judah, he sees a lamb. And a lamb standing, as it were, slain. Oftentimes when you see the image of the Lamb of God, it's kind of like sprawled across a book with seven seals hanging off of it. But that's not the vision of the Apocalypse. The Lion of Judah is this lamb standing, alive, and yet slain. The simultaneity of life and death. So when our Lord tells Thomas to come here and put your finger, he's showing these open wounds, the simultaneity, this mystery. Now, this should sound familiar because you know that the Catholic doctrine concerning the Mass, that this sacrifice of the Eucharist is simultaneously our Lord's death and resurrection. It is both of them and, in a sense, neither of them, because the reality is the transformation in the divine light. So the simultaneity of life and death is one of the things we learn from this mystery of the resurrection. That every grace that we receive has both the mark of life and of crucifixion in it. So we should never be surprised when we advance in the spiritual life that sometimes it seems to become more difficult. That cross can only pass Calvary into the light of glory. So this is part of the rebuke and the humiliation to Thomas. What our Lord is saying to him, what's clear from the text is, Thomas has not lost the faith. You can tell from the Greek, you can't tell from it in the English, but the tense that's used in the verse is that St. Thomas hasn't lost the belief in the Messiah, but he's on his way to losing it. Which is why our Lord says to him, do not be unbelieving, but believing. Stop yourself now, before you lose it. I mean, we all have members of our families who have done just what Thomas did. Well, you know, the Catholic Church, Father so-and-so, such a jerk. And I'm not going. So they don't go. And then they don't go another month. And then they don't go another month. And then they don't go for a year. And then they don't go for 2 years. They have put themselves on a path that they may have believed at one time, but they no longer believe. There's no longer an illumination of the mind. Because when we play with this mystery, which is precisely Thomas on this new Sunday, our Lord is cautioning him, do not be unbelieving, but believe. So on his path to losing it, what our Lord is rebuking him, is reminding him, is that your faith is not something which belongs to you. It doesn't originate in you. It is given to you to enter into the divine light and to know the mind of God. As charity gives us the ability to love with the divine love. And the other part of the rebuke is that the faith is not only not from you in origin, is that the faith is corporate. The faith is in the body of Christ. And this is a huge distinction between Catholicism and Protestantism. And unfortunately, because we live in a Protestant nation, we're three-quarters Protestant just by atmosphere, by osmosis. Every day in the Creed, we profess that we believe in one holy Catholic and Apostolic Church. This isn't just pointing out some institution. This is pointing out the reality of which we are members of one body of Christ. And Thomas is being rebuked because the apostles, with whom he is a corporate body within Christ, and these women in the garden, have all given testimony that he has risen from the dead, and Thomas disregards all of them. Now, the reason why I mentioned the distinction between Catholicism and Protestantism is because in Protestantism, the great emphasis is upon me and Jesus and my relation with Jesus. Me, me, me. It's always individual. Whereas the Catholic faith, we're in this together. And when the church goes through rocky periods, we all get slammed around and bruised. And when she does things gloriously, which is actually quite honestly rather rare because of human nature throughout history, we all do great. So there is an aspect in which our faith is part of a whole and us individually. So Thomas is rebuked because he disregards the testimony of the people around him. And even more so because he's known them for years and he knows that they are good. And so our Lord doesn't accept that excuse. Well, I didn't see. I didn't touch. You didn't prove it to me. And I'll make a little confession here. Because I think all of us at some point probably go through this stage. And in my middle school years, I did just that. The prayers were, as a stupid teenager, a middle school kid, you know, which doesn't make us stupid at all. I love these guys. But it's a part in our lives in which my prayer, personally, this is my confession, no one else's, is that the prayer in those couple few years were, if you exist, prove it to me. As if somehow God the side of responsibility, and I was the one to whom something was due. Of course, this is ridiculous when you stop and think about it in this way. But as a teenager, I was thinking that I was becoming quite mature. You know, if you exist, fine, make an example to me, make it clear. Thanks be to God, I outgrew that. But on the other hand, thanks be to God that I didn't, having put myself on that path of a faith which begins to disappear, that it didn't disappear. So like St. Thomas putting himself on that path. Because obviously otherwise I wouldn't be a Catholic, and I certainly wouldn't be a priest, and I wouldn't be here torturing you with hour and a half sermons every week. But I think that most of us go at some point in our lives, and we may not be when we're middle school kids. It may be when we're 45 and going through our midlife crisis. That it's up to God to prove to me somehow, me personally, that all of this exists. And the fact of the thousands of saints that we have recognized, let alone the millions who are in heaven, the entire history of 20 centuries of Catholicism in the world, that somehow none of that is sufficient for me to believe. I need something for me individually. That's profoundly arrogant and profoundly self-centered, because the testimony is there for those who have eyes to see. So in one aspect, our Lord is rebuking St. Thomas, because he's become so individualized and selfish and not accepted that testimony. And the second thing is that he rebukes him because of the fact that he's not accepting that corporate testimony. And that's why our Lord then says, Thomas, because you've seen, you've believed. Fine, that's really what you need. That's kind of the attitude. But he says, blessed are those, truly happy, truly blessed are those who have not seen and yet have believed. That's us. In fact, that's everyone besides the people who were in that room and in that garden and there during that month of our Lord's presence in his glory. And from that aspect, of course, we sometimes forget that our faith came to us somewhere. None of us just went one day into Barnes & Noble and bought a thing called the Bible and just read it and decided, hey, there's something really interesting in this book, and I think I'll make up something and call it Christianity. We have all come to the faith through someone. It might be our parents. It might be colleagues. Who knows? But what we often forget is that that person or persons also came to the faith by someone else's testimony. And they from their testimony. In the catechism class last night that I was having, I was talking about a gentleman that I knew when I was in high school, past that adolescent prayer. And this gentleman's name was Joseph Schadhofer. Not very Lebanese, I know. But Joe Hud, when I was 16, 17, Joe Schadhofer was the oldest person I knew. Because he was over 100. And at Mass every Sunday, he was a carpenter, had been born in Germany. And when he died in 1984, he was 104. This man had been born in 1880. And he was an extraordinary man of faith, profound. But as my adolescent mind was expanding to a better understanding of history, I was thinking, when this man was born, Leo XIII was Pope. When he went to go sign up for World War I as a volunteer, he was rejected because he was too old. Because he was already in his late 30s, they wouldn't have him sign up. And then what was interesting, because it was 1980, and he was talking about the softness of Catholics, this kind of like this bottoming out of Catholicism in the last 40 years. The reason why almost every one of you can just have your own personal pew, because the rest of the church is empty. Where is everybody? What the heck has happened? How often have people put themselves on the path of Thomas? But Jerry Schoenhofer had a solution in his profound carpenter practicality. And he said, the beginning of the end was when they patted the kneelers. So he's remembering in the 1920s, when they started patting what had just been wooden planks that just flopped down in front of your pew. And of course, in the ancient churches, we don't even have pews. You just knelt down on the stone floor. And he says, that was the beginning of the end. You wanted it soft. And then we changed the fasting. And that went out the window. And one thing after another, until once you put yourself on that path, it's inevitable that you lose everything. So Joe Schoenhofer, even though none of you never knew him, God bless this old man, was a wonderful connection of the idea. Who gave witness to him? Certainly his parents in 1880. And they received before, and they received before, and sometimes we forget that we, in 2018, are the end of an unbroken chain of individuals who have said, he is risen. All the way back to those men and women in the garden. Thomas put himself on a path that he may have broken that chain if he had continued on that course. Thanks be to God, the contrary happened. In fact, St. Thomas is the apostle of Mesopotamia and of India. He is part directly related to the heritage of the Maronite Church, St. Thomas. But St. Thomas, as an example in the Gospel today, was beginning a path which was stopped. But it's a path which has been repeated far too often, especially in the second half of the 20th century, of people who received the link from 1880 and who said in 1976, this is stupid. I'm going to camp. I'm going to the beach. We're going to do something else. And then we thought, well, we don't need to go every Sunday. And then it was twice a month. Twice a month, you know, once a month is fine. God doesn't expect all of this from us. And then it became once every 2 months, and then it would become Christmas and Easter. And you can see how the logic becomes that it just evaporates. So on this new Sunday, what our Lord is doing is reminding us, lock back into the light that has been given to you and witnessed to you well over 20 centuries now. Understand that for each of us, it is a gift. It is something which is to be cherished and treasured. And as we say in the modern world, use it or lose it. So if the faith is not lived, it will just disappear. No matter how Catholic we think we are, because we have a great grandfather or a great grandmother who was very pious. Her piety will not save me on Judgment Day. His testimony will not save me on Judgment Day. Though the faith is corporate through witness, each of us stands naked alone on the day of our death. And this reality of St. Thomas, we want to embrace. Blessed are those who have not seen and yet believe. That is the invitation of New Sunday for each of us to enter into the light of the new creation. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, amen.